A Canadian comedian is facing a $35,000 fine for telling an offensive joke something like 6 or 7 years ago. I kid you not. Now, initially, they wanted him to pay an additional $7,000 to the victim's mother, because apparently he made fun of this guy here who's got some syndrome that makes it so he doesn't fully, his face doesn't fully form, and he made fun of him for a while. It was a joke about Make-A-Wish, and I'll get into this, okay? And then apparently the court said you got to pay his mom too, but they overturned that. Still, they're telling him to pay $35K and he's refusing to do it. Canada, of all places. I can't say I'm surprised. They've been continually falling more towards this fringe far left ideology. But I'll tell you what, man, I don't know a whole lot about Canada. I'm not Canadian. And maybe they've been this way the whole time. But I will say something before we read this, and maybe I'll bring it up later. All of those people who are like, oh no, Donald Trump, oh heavens, I should move to Canada. Please, please, please go move to Canada. You know why? Because then you can see what it's like to live without freedoms. Because this is a joke, right? Was it intended to actually offend the guy? No. In fact, the story isn't true. He embellished everything. He was just using it as a launching point. Okay? Can someone, how do you know whether or not someone can handle having a joke told about them? When people make fun of me, I don't get angry. Should I? If someone in Canada talks smack about me, can I force them to pay me? That's ridiculous. So what happens if you say, if you go up to somebody in Canada and say, I think you have funny looking curly hair. And they laugh and say, oh yeah, I think it is kind of funny looking. You're fine. But if they go, how dare you? What if you compliment them and they don't take it as a compliment? I really like your dimples. How dare you mock me? Who determines what is or isn't offensive? A court? They're going to be like, What if in this joke, he started by saying, what a great proud and amazing person. What if he framed it all as positives, but still made it funny in a negative light? How do you police this kind of stuff? It's absolutely, let me read the story before we get carried away. They say a Quebec judge rejected part of comedian Mike Ward's appeal regarding a joke about a disabled boy. Ward was ordered to pay $35,000 to Jeremy Gabriel, who suffers from a genetic disorder that causes facial deformity and affects his hearing due to a joke the comedian told at shows between 2010 and 2013. Two of three judges ruled Mike Ward's comments regarding Gabriel were not justifiable in a society where freedom of expression is valued. No, it isn't. I don't know if that's an editorial statement from Post-Millennial or if that's literally what the judge said. I'll tell you what, Canada is not for free expression. They are the opposite. It's probably why so many Canadians come here to tell jokes. They say Ward was originally ordered to pay an additional $7,000 to Gabriel's mother, a fine which the courts overturned due to the indirect relationship between the joke and the boy's mother. The joke in question was regarding Gabriel's disability. In 2005, Gabriel sang to Pope Benedict and Celine Dion to flesh out his dream of becoming an international singer. Ward's jokes called Gabriel a bad singer, stating that he was terminally ill, and that Gabriel not passing away meant that his Make-A-Wish was invalid. Gabriel was not actually terminally ill, as Gabriel's genetic disease, Treacher-Collins syndrome, does not generally have an effect on lifespan. He was also not a Make-A-Wish kid, as Ward was embellishing the story for the sake of the joke. Ward added that he tried to drown Gabriel, but he wouldn't die. So I look, the joke is told in French. I can only assume that what he's basically saying is, by drowning him, it would validate the Make-A-Wish, I guess. It was a joke. It's not a real story. These people can't tell the difference between jokes. So here's the thing. Like I mentioned, how do you determine what's offensive? Let's say there's somebody who's a jockey, right? So jockeys who ride horses tend to be small people. What if I laughed and said, this guy will never play in the NBA. You want to be in the NBA? Too bad. You're too short. Is that what the guy's like? What if I don't want to be in the NBA? How do you determine the intent of an individual and whether or not it's offensive to make a statement about somebody who literally can't do a thing? You see, the point I'm trying to make is this dude who's got this syndrome, probably never going to be an internationally recognized singer because only it's 0.00000001% of people, probably less. There's like, it's a small amount of people who become internationally recognized singers. I know some people who are famous musicians. You probably wouldn't even know their name. And they play to big audiences, but they are not like Beyonce, and you probably do know that name. So here's the thing, man. Are we not allowed to point out that some people can't do some things? I think that's really where we're going. It's the craziest thing, and it's got this overlap with socialism. where basically, you know, I was talking to people. I know it's kind of derailing from free speech into socialism, but there's a point here, right? Think about what this is. You must respect this individual who can't be a singer. You must respect their wish to be one. I don't got to respect anything. I live in America. I have a First Amendment right, and I'm glad I do. Man, it's getting scary, I'll admit, especially with these social media companies not respecting free expression and falling into this mindset, and we're doomed. We really are. I'll get into this, right? But I'll tell you what happens. Under this utopian socialist idea, everybody will just do whatever they want to do. It literally makes no sense. And I'm not exaggerating. I got into a Twitter fight with the Socialist Party of Great Britain or whatever, and we were talking. I wouldn't necessarily call it an argument. It was a discussion. And I said, under socialism, what if I don't know, I've never built a car before. I know nothing about building a car. But what if I wanted to do that? They said, well, you would just go and do it. Well, how would I get the parts to build the car? And he said, you would just go down to the factory and get the parts. And I'm like, okay, why would the factory give me, someone who has literally no idea how to build a car, the parts? Certainly parts are not infinite and they'd want to prioritize them, right? And they said something to the effect of course. The people who build cars would get first access. I said, so what you're saying is that I can't choose because I would be last in line? Well, see, under capitalism, I can work and trade as I see fit. So if I have something of value, I can go to the car people and say, you know what? It's probably going to sit in my garage. Don't know how to build a car, but I can do it if I want to. And that's a hobby. But here's the thing. Ain't nobody got to pay me when I build a crappy car or fail to do so. It's something I want to pursue and explore, and that freedom allows us to expand and discover what we can really do. And I'll tell you what, that means this kid under capitalism would absolutely be allowed to be a great singer. Oh, he's probably not going to be a great singer, right? But he can sing. Nobody's got to pay him to do it. Think about the two scenarios that we would get under socialism. For one, people who might be good at a job will not be allowed to do it because they'll be told, this is the job you're better at, you must do this. You won't be free to explore. Or you have a society where people literally can just, like the Socialist Party said, anybody can just do anything, even if you're physically incapable of doing it. So here's what I tell people. Imagine you have a friend. You need to imagine. How many people do you know who play musical instruments? You can probably say, oh, I know a handful, right? How many of them would love to be a famous musician? They got a leg up on this guy. They actually play the instrument. Ah, but then how many of them do you think would actually make it? Yeah, that's what I thought. Probably none. Some of them might be, you know, like a studio musician. They can play the guitar, but they're not really good at writing. And see, the thing is, in this socialist utopia world, they tell you that you, someone who is, you know, has a genetic disease that causes malformation, or I don't know, is that offensive? I have no idea. But you're likely not going to fit the bracket required to be a great singer. Under their utopian vision, they would say, but you can do it anyway, and we're going to pay for it. But if you're not producing something of value that people want, where does that money come from to keep feeding you? Take it away from singing. Singing's more abstract. Let's talk about somebody who bakes cake. Okay, that's food. No, let's not even do cake. Let's do bread. Basic necessity, okay? General food. Bread's not that great for you. You shouldn't eat it, but anyway, you make bread, right? Let's say someone says, I want to be a baker. And in the socialist utopia, we must respect their right to bake that bread. And they keep making crap that nobody wants to eat, nor can, because it's too hard and it's just wasting resources. That clearly can't exist, right? Certainly someone must come in and say, dude, you can't do this anymore. Well, guess what happens? Then you can't bake bread. Then you're never going to get access to the ingredients to make bread because the socialist system will say, we're not going to prioritize resources towards someone for a hobby. You see the problem here? Is that there's this weird overlap between everyone should be allowed to do whatever. You have to respect this person. And if you don't, we will punish you. Maybe that's how they'll end up paying for people to do ridiculous things. But I tell you what, this kind of stuff, I know I kind of got into socialism on this, but it's a free speech issue. It's all kind of interlinked between people who think they deserve everything. Why should this guy get $35,000 because someone said mean words about you? Are you kidding me, dude? How about I say this? What's this guy's name? I don't know the guy's name. Gabriel? No, yeah, Gabriel. Okay, Gabriel, I think you are a bad person. Am I going to have to be, look, I get it, right? Making fun of, it's hate speech, whatever, calling you a bad person isn't. The point is, are we going to leave it up to a court today to to determine what is, and then it changes later. It literally makes no sense, and it can't be enforced. But all of these things are moving in a direction where everyone thinks they deserve everything, and they don't. Let's read a little bit more, but I want to make the bigger point about free speech and the danger we're facing. In a free, quote, in a free country, it shouldn't be up to a judge to decide what constitutes a joke on stage, he wrote. The people in attendance laughing already answered that question. Ward's lawyer, Julius Gray, believes the decision seriously impacts the world of stand-up comedy. In this particular case, if the judgment is maintained, no one will be able to dare to be a stand-up comic because normally you make fun of things that are controversial. Otherwise, it's not funny. If anything that is controversial can authorize someone to say, I was hurt, I'm going to court, we're finished. Yeah, I'd be surprised if stand-up comedians had wanted to keep performing in Canada, because that's insane. They're going to fine you because you were mean to somebody? What if you insult the president, the prime minister, or otherwise? You can't do that. It's offensive. You must pay a fine. So I'll tell you what. People then come to the U.S. But you know what? I'll take it. I'll take that brain drain, right? Your skilled elites. Mike, come on down to Philadelphia. Stand up. People will clap for you and cheer for you. You might get some protesters calling you bigot, but whatever. At least nobody will arrest you. Nobody will force you to pay a $35,000 fine. Because even as a tourist or somebody here on an artist visa, those who enter the United States, even illegally, do have constitutional protections. To a certain degree, I don't know the exact, you know, how it exactly works, but you do have free speech and in a second, third, fourth, fifth, etc. But I'll tell you what, I'm not going to show too much because it'll get me in trouble on YouTube, but I want to make sure you know this is happening. Angela Merkel gave a speech where she said, basically, freedom of speech doesn't mean freedom from consequence, and that they got to ban hate speech. And we have another story about Ilhan Omar's Republican, competitor or whatever, rival. There's many people who want to challenge Ilhan Omar, but one of her, you know, contenders for the 2020 congressional seat said that Ilhan Omar should be tried for treason if these rumors are true about her passing off, you know, information to Iran. And if it is, she should be hanged because that's the penalty for treason, which it is. Well, this woman was then banned from Twitter for saying that. But she was basically saying this person has been accused of a crime, and if it's true, she should face the legal penalty. I don't agree with what she says, and I think the story about Ilhan Omar is absurd and most likely not true. But you got to recognize the predicament we're in. When a private company can supersede calls for the rule of law. So we're in a situation where someone says, Twitter is banning people for legal speech. Well, that's another issue because Twitter is a private platform, right? What happens when someone says, I would like to see US law enforced and Twitter bans you because of it? That means with Trump spending ridiculous amounts of money on Facebook, we know the power of social media. These private companies can literally get rid of it. They could ban anybody who says we should uphold our laws and promote anybody who says not to. That's where we're headed. This is where we're going. Comedians getting fined and threatened over jokes. The loss of free speech. I'll leave you with one quick thing. There's a comedian named Rafinha Bastos. He's Brazilian. So it's spelled R-A-F-H-I-N-A, I think. So it's like Rafinha Bastos. Look into this guy. Okay, I actually know him personally. He's a good dude. He told a joke, a dark humor joke on TV, and it was pretty dark. But I get it. It was funny. And he actually got, I believe he got threatened with jail time over. That's Brazil. No free speech. And he was sued. I think he's now in the U.S. But you know what? I think he's in the U.S. I'm not entirely sure, but I'll tell you this. All of these comedians around the world, just come on down to good old US of A and be as offensive as possible, and we'll pay you to see it. You know, I will give you cold, hard pictures of dead presidents so that you can make offensive jokes because we have the First Amendment here. You might have to, when you go home, they might, you know, arrest you. I don't know. But hey, I'm thankful to the Founding Fathers every single day. I'll leave it there. Stick around. Next segment's coming up at 4 p.m. YouTube.com/TimCast. It is a different channel, and I will see you then.